Folks, want to take your seats, so we'll get started. Welcome to the panel on financing and governing the 21st Century Harbor. My name is Rob Pirani. I'm the Vice President for Environmental Programs at Regional Plan Association. Folks might know RPA is a nonprofit research, planning, and advocacy organization, and I'm thrilled to be here with a terrific panel. I think as you heard this morning, we do have a challenge. Financing this harbor, the wonderful public access sites that have grown around the harbor in both New York and New Jersey, and making sure that they stay well-maintained and well-cared for is an expensive proposition. And it's a challenge that we all face in the coming years, and one that we have a terrific panel to help explore those. The good news is that this generation has seen an incredible explosion of these public parks and public spaces. I think it's safe to say that in 50 years, park historians and New York City aficionados will look back at this era as being a place just like the 1860s with Central Park, or the 1930s. Or in the 1960s in the Moses Sears Parks, is one of the great eras of park construction in New York City and New Jersey. We were fortunate a few years ago to receive some money from the J.M. Kaplan Fund to examine this issue of how we're going to take care of these great parks. At that time, there were close to 700 acres of waterfront parks and public spaces in more than 50 projects under construction. Nearly 60 miles of waterfront access through parks, greenways, and esplanades. And of course, the traditional model, and I think the expectation among the general public, is that these public spaces are the responsibility of some parks agency somewhere, that they'll be taken care of by the government, and perhaps there'll be some aid from a local friends group, but that it was a general public responsibility. But of course, the problem, and this is kind of the bad news, is that the Parks Department doesn't have the money to do that. The Parks Department, whether we're talking about New York City Parks, New York State Parks, New Jersey DEP, the county park system in Hudson County, or the National Park Service. Waterfront parks are expensive. On average, they cost about $135,000 an acre here in New York City to take care of. And so the question is, how do we pay for all these great public spaces? Now part of the puzzle is, sort of the familiar story of looking for money somewhere else. Certainly I would encourage everyone to go learn more about the Harbor Coalition. There's a booth outside, and then we're having a couple of sessions this afternoon. And of course, our idea is that we're going to go and find some additional money from down in Washington, and I have every confidence that we'll be successful in doing that, but it's not going to be enough, of course. What park advocates and managers and community groups have realized is that we need to look elsewhere right here at home, and there's been a tremendous surge in different models for how to do that. And why not? We know that parks create values. RPA did a study a few years ago for Friends of Hudson River Park that found that right outside Hudson River Park, right here down in Greenwich Village, there was 20% of the land value within the two-block radius was attributable to the park. And for a $75 million investment, the city and state created $200 million in value. So why not capture that windfall and put it to work maintaining the public space, that shared value? It's of course and in some view, this kind of a win-win solution, right? We're creating value. Let's use that value to maintain it, to maintain the value, and create a kind of a virtuous cycle. Can we really create these kind of parks that pay them for themselves? And is it really a good idea? Does it work everywhere? Because moving parks management away from that idea of it being sort of an essential public service that's guaranteed, sort of equally everywhere, really takes away from what some might view as being the park's ideal, the idea of a democratic, diverse and non-commercialized space. You know, to put it another way, how do we find the right balance between the sort of focus and attention and entrepreneurial spirit that park managers are taking in finding funding right within their neighborhoods for their parks, and the idea of a park system that allocates resources equitably across an entire system and balances needs and opportunities for the city as a whole or for the region as a whole. So this panel is going to explore ways of funding the maintenance and operations of all these publicly owned waterfront parks, and really, you know, talk about what are the possibilities, what are the models that are out there, what are the solutions, and can we do that in a way that's equitable for everybody? Let me quickly introduce them. You have their complete bios in their packet. Right here is Jamie Springer, who's a partner in HRNA Advisor, who's going to showcase some of the some results from a national survey they did on financing parks. Chris Rizzo is a counsel at Carter, Ledyard & Milburn, and is going to add some details on that and talk about some of the legal challenges involved in these new models. And then Holly Light, executive director for the New Yorkers for Parks, is going to place those models within the context of a citywide system. Can we use those models and at the same time achieve that kind of citywide goal? And then batting cleanup, we have Senator Daniel Squadron, one of our great public leaders. Daniel represents Lower Manhattan and Brooklyn Waterfront and has been a leader in formulating agreements for Brooklyn Bridge Park and other parks in his district. And he's going to kind of talk about the sort of the political realities of making it all work. So, and then hopefully we're you know, of course, asking the impossible of our folks, and they're going to speak for about 7 minutes each, and then we'll leave some time for some panel discussion and Q&A from the audience. So with that, let me turn it over to Jamie.
Thanks, Rob. Can everyone hear me? So we work on financing strategies for recreational space and other elements of urban public infrastructure across the country and around the world. And increasingly, that means working on financing waterfront parks, because there really is a movement in North America and around the world, very much stimulated and catalyzed by the work that's been done in our harbor over the last 10 or 15 years, to build waterfront parks as amenities to support new development and urban growth. And I think, you know, I've been asked to sort of frame this discussion and be maybe a little bit provocative as well about how funding sources can be derived. And I think what's interesting is that the idea of privately financing infrastructure like parks through groups like conservancies and other nonprofit entities, it really originated and grew in New York over the last 30 or 40 years. But there have been innovations elsewhere, particularly in the last decade. And I think it's interesting now to start bringing some of those lessons back and think about it in relation to our harbor. So, you know, as I say, we're working really from Corpus Christi in the south to Toronto in the north, from San Diego in the west to all around New York and Boston in the east. And there are lots of interesting examples that we can bring back. And I think when we think about how to approach a financing strategy, it really starts with follow the money. But in something of a more subtle way, following the money means following the value that gets created when you invest in a new waterfront recreational space. And in fact, by following the money and bringing it in as part of your park project, you can also create that value and augment that value. So, you know, Rob was talking about the increments that we've witnessed in real estate values in the village because of Hudson River Park. There are lots of studies of that, but parks are really unique drivers of economic development because they're not just like, it's not just a convention center where you build a convention center and you're bringing in, you hope, more business tourism. Usually you build a convention center, you bring in a lot more locals, and you're not always so happy about that because that's not where the increment is from. But in a park, there's different user groups who come to a park and really value it, and that's where the value gets generated. You've got the user that spends, that engages in arts and cultural recreation increasingly in parks, that just values it for their quality of life. It's why they go to a waterfront, why they go to a park. You've got the local neighborhood that has that benefit of the real estate increment, but you've also got increasingly, again, people who come to destination parks across the country in order to enjoy them, and they spend money, and they extend their stay, and they do other things within that local economy. So there's very significant increments to value that are created, and financing waterfront open space is about figuring out how to harness that value. Rob mentioned this. One of the reasons that this is so difficult is that it's expensive to build waterfront parks, but also to operate and maintain. He had a number in the hundreds of thousands for New York. Waterfront parks on average from survey work we've done are in the, more in the range of $250,000 an acre per year for operation and maintenance in addition to capital cost. And obviously we've got government retrenchment across the country that's not helping. But in some ways, you know, I think as we do this work across the country, we observe that in some ways there's a real value that's gained from that. Innovation gets stimulated in the vacuum that's created by the absence of government funds and by this big nut that you have to crack when you're trying to finance a waterfront open space. We did do a survey in cooperation with the City Parks Alliance this year and found that this wasn't just waterfront parks, but the entities that we surveyed, almost all of them bring in philanthropic contributions. Almost all of them have significant earned income activity in their parks, whether that's events, concessions, fees for programmed events. Again, two-thirds receive public funding, which is clearly down from 20 or 30 years ago, but is still very important. And then, you know, a smaller number engage in capturing value from real estate, which is something that's been pioneered very much in New York and our harbor and is spreading as an approach. But you know, the way that I think we think is most important to think about this is that philanthropy is increasingly important and creates that sense of ownership and engagement. And also we see, you know, Brooklyn Bridge Park and others are great examples in New York, but there are examples around the world where real estate development doesn't just provide us with a sustainable funding base for a park, it also creates a local constituency that will go to the park and walk their dog or run through the park or walk through the park day in and day out because they're immediately adjacent. And that adds a tremendous amount of value to the open space. So just to highlight some best practices, a stable public base is unquestionably critical, and our city is committed to providing a stable base, at least of capital, for recreational open space. But you can see that this graph shows you it's most important in the early years. New parks are most dependent on a stable base of public funding because the other funding sources haven't emerged yet. It takes a while to get a good concession going. It takes a while to realize the value from real estate development and property appreciation around a park. So the government needs to intervene, and most forcefully at the beginning of things. Earned income, there are great best practices in having events held in parks. You know, a lot of us know ACL, Austin City Limits, and South by Southwest, and the tremendous activities that are happening in Austin these days in the cultural realm that keeps Austin weird, as they like to say. But a lot of us don't know that ACL is really held in a waterfront park along Lady Bird Lake. And the Austin City Parks Department takes in a tremendous amount of fees from holding that event. We do that very well here, clearly. We program our harbor very effectively, but it's something that we need to think more about as we expand the amount of open space that we have in the harbor. What kind of events can we hold there, and also what kind of concessions can we hold there? One other sort of thing that I think is being very much pioneered elsewhere as well as here is providing long-term concession leases, something that's very much under debate for this park and for other parks around the harbor. But the longer the lease, the more a private entity has time to amortize a capital investment. And so the better a concession we get and the more revenue that we can generate from it. So a really critical tool for generating more value. Lots of innovation in private fundraising. I actually spent the first 3 days of this week in Corpus Christi, where a community is so engaged in building a 34-acre bayfront park along its bay waterfront at the edge of the Gulf, that we spoke to 1,200 people in 3 days. And so when you have that many people engaged in a park, you know that's the opportunity to go and raise a lot of money from them. And each of those meetings was about showing them a wonderful design for a park, which you can see an example of here, but also we were very much pushing and approaching people to start making contributions. And an innovation in this case is that there appears to be enough capital funding available for that park. So the intent is to make a commitment to raise probably something like $15 million in private money that will form an endowment which can be used for operation, maintenance, programming, and activation of the park. And effectively, by making that commitment, the folks that are trying to get this park built are unlocking the public commitment. So it's very much a very strong public-private partnership and an innovation in the use of private funds. Lots of innovation also in leveraging the value of real estate development. My hometown of Toronto is undertaking the largest urban regeneration project in North America. They have a $1.5 billion infrastructure funding commitment from three levels of government up there. But what they're really doing is taking precincts along their waterfront, putting in basic infrastructure, acquiring as much of the land as they can, and then selling it through strategic disposition, and using that to fund the open space that will very much become the future recreational areas of that city's lakefront. And they've done it with great success so far, and are still working through some of the issues around the upfront financing of those proceeds versus the long period of time that it takes for them to come in, but a big innovation. And then, of course, never forget that the Olympic Park that will be the big scene in a few weeks in London is a £9 billion public infrastructure investment that includes a strategy to regenerate a big swath of East London. And what the national government has done there is they plan to have a community be created within the Olympic Estate along the River Lee. So this is a waterfront park. The 7,000 units of housing that get created there will be sold based on public land and go back into restoring the fund, some of that £9 billion they've invested in the Olympics. But in addition to getting the proceeds from that, the Olympic Estate will also get 15,000 people living there. And that's important because to activate a waterfront park, you want people living nearby. So a very effective strategy among many that are being undertaken in different parts of the country and the world. And just a last word, I know we'll have some more discussion about this, but it seems that when we talk about how to govern, what the governance strategy is, it's very much dependent on where you think the money is going to come from. So, you know, in the old days, we had the city funding all of the operation and maintenance costs, so there's no reason that the Parks Department shouldn't be undertaking that maintenance. But increasingly, we see as funding sources diversify and we have more private sources, we see innovation in governance as well, because it means that you're more effectively able to leverage those private funds. A lot more to say about that. Maybe I'll leave that for someone else or for later. Thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Chris Rizzo, and that's a perfect introduction, Jamie, into the topic that I need to talk about, which is legal considerations and some of these alternative financing schemes for parks. I've been involved in park issues for about 15 years, and what I've observed, many others have, is this contradiction in park policy in New York State and New York City, which is a dramatic expansion in the number of parks and in the acreage of parks, which is wonderful, but a serious cut in maintenance funding for parks. That's true at the state level, and it's true in New York City. And so I've started to think a lot about, over the past few years, alternative financing strategies for parks and the legalities of those financing strategies. And I want to talk about five today, which I think are the most promising and the ones that are most talked about. One is the sale or lease of parkland to finance other park improvements. The second is commercial uses in parks, revenue generating uses, in other words. The third is private management of parks, which we see a lot of in New York City. And then the last two, which we don't see a lot of in New York State and New York City, that's tax increment financing for parks, and the other is a transfer development rights scheme, zoning scheme, to fund parkland improvements. So the first idea is alienation. And that term refers to the sale or lease or conversion of parkland to a non-park purpose. And what courts in New York State have held again and again is that the state, counties, and municipalities can't do this without state legislative approval. But it happens all the time. We took a look at the past decade of bills in the state legislature dealing with alienations, and there are at least 300 acres of parkland that have been alienated in New York State for financing other park improvements. Now, in Suffolk County and Rockland County, it might be alienating parkland to put in cell phone towers to fund park improvements or to fund the parkland that they're going to be built on. There's Yankee Stadium. There's the filtration plant that New York City built in Van Cortlandt Park. There are endless number of leases of parkland to private golf course operators to bring about improvements to those parks. The idea is kind of heretical to park advocates, but again, it is going on all the time in New York State, and it raises important policy considerations that we need to think about. The second idea is this idea of putting commercial uses into parkland. Again, this is something that happens all the time in New York State. You've got Shake Shack in Madison Square Park, you've got the Union Square Grill, you've got Brooklyn Bridge Park, which is going to be home to a number of residential buildings. You've got the Gideon Putnam Hotel in Saratoga Springs, which is wonderful. You've got Donald Trump's proposed catering facility at Jones Beach. It's happening all the time. But courts have held that some of these commercial uses are okay, some of them are not. You really need to ask a number of questions before you go and put one of these facilities in a park. You need to ask questions like, does it really serve park purposes? If it doesn't, it may not be an appropriate use. You have to ask questions about whether it's going to be privately or publicly operated. You need to ask questions about whether it will be governed by a license or a lease. The lease of parkland, courts have held, is actually illegal, although municipalities try to do it all the time. You have to look at the enabling legislation that created the park. In Brooklyn Bridge Park and in Hudson River Park, you have a special legal mechanism that allows the entities that manage those parks to put commercial uses in there to fund the parks. So these are some of the questions you need to think about in exploring this option. The third option is private management. We see a lot more of this in New York City these days. And it basically takes four forms. In Bryant Park, you have a business improvement district, which levies taxes on nearby property owners to fund Bryant Park. Obviously very successful, it's a beautiful park. In Central Park, you have a private foundation, essentially a friends group, which raises money from the private sector and has created an endowment for Central Park. In Brooklyn Bridge Park and in Hudson River Park here, you have a state-created public benefit corporation, which raises money for the park. And in some cases, you simply have municipalities that lease out, as I said, parkland to private operators of golf courses and recreational facilities. There's nothing inherently illegal about any of these mechanisms, but they do raise some interesting legal questions, like how are First Amendment issues going to be handled? That's been an issue with Occupy Wall Street, which took place in Zuccotti Park, which is actually a privately owned public park. Sorting out these legal questions is very important, and it's a viable option for funding parkland. This is really an obscure idea in New York State and in New York City. This is tax increment finance. But it's done all the time in other cities, particularly in Illinois and Chicago, with great benefit. The picture up there is of a waterfront park in Chicago, which was funded with tax increment financing. New York State law allows municipalities to create a tax increment finance project, to sell bonds, to use the funds from those bonds to carry out park improvements or transit improvements, and then to use the increase in property taxes around the park, hopefully that's been spurred by the park, to pay off the bonds and pay off the bondholders. There's tremendous fear in New York State, I think, that issuing these kinds of bonds is too dangerous, might not raise enough property taxes and create enough revenue to actually pay back these bonds. So in 2002 and 2003, New York City proposed to fund the Hudson Yards project, the subway line, Hudson Park, the new boulevard, all these great public amenities with tax increment finance bonds. And there was tremendous concern that the project wouldn't generate enough private property taxes to pay back these bonds. And so the idea was scrapped and a similar model was used. But I think there's a lot of merit and there's a lot of options here. Last, you've got the transfer of development rights. New York State law allows municipalities to create this kind of mechanism. The most prominent use of this sort of zoning scheme is on Long Island. Some of you may be familiar with the Central Pine Barrens, which is a really amazing 100,000-acre ecosystem in Suffolk County. Very fragile, very unique. And what the towns of Brookhaven, Riverhead, and Southampton did a couple of decades ago is to create a TDR zoning scheme where owners of property within the 100,000-acre preservation zone could sell their development rights to growth zones outside of this ecosystem, and thereby allow the owners of the property that the towns wanted to preserve to realize the benefit of their privately held land and to push development out to the areas where the municipalities actually wanted it to happen. And it's been attributed to at least 1,800 acres of preserved land, and a lot of the other portions of the preserve have been bought up with county money or municipal money. The best example, the only example in New York City that I really know of, is for the High Line, where there is essentially a TDR zoning scheme that is intended to fund maintenance and completion of the High Line, the High Line Improvement Fund. If you have property that's under the High Line or immediately adjacent, you can build bulkier buildings away from, if you transfer development rights from right next to the High Line, you can build bulkier buildings away from the High Line to preserve light and air for it. And if you're not, if you own a property that's not immediately adjacent to the High Line, you can buy development rights for, I think, $50 a square foot from the High Line. And that just happened to Chelsea Market, where the owner of Chelsea Market paid $19 million to the High Line Improvement Fund in exchange for 330,000 square feet of new development rights. So this is a viable option. I can see it being used all over New York City, to be honest, both for new parkland as well as for financing for existing parkland. How about the green belt on Staten Island? This is a really a precious area in the central portion of Staten Island, some of which is still in private hands, but has always been intended for preservation. What about a transfer of development rights scheme that allows private property owners there to sell off their development rights to other parts of to development sites on other parts of Staten Island where the city really wants to see development happen, like Georgetown and Stapleton? I have a picture up there, and then I'll conclude, of the Van Cortlandt Park Motel, which is a hot sheets motel across the street from Van Cortlandt Park in the Bronx. This is an amazing park. It's the fourth largest park in New York City. It's my favorite park. I live near it, not surprisingly. And I can't imagine that that's the best use for directly across the street from this park. It can't possibly be. I can only imagine what a tax increment finance scheme, a transfer of development rights scheme would involving Van Cortlandt Park could do to that development site and to other development sites around the park. There's a lot of hope here. And I'll conclude with that.
So Chris ended on a hopeful note, and I guess I'm going to be now the Cassandra who's throwing out all the warning signs. Rob talked about how successful the city has been in recent years in creating new waterfront parks, and every time I hear about these, or I actually was reading this morning a 1999 report that we did when we were the Parks Council about all of these great waterfront ideas, and tons of them have come to fruition. But I read these things with mixed feelings, and the more I understand about the Parks Department's budget and these various alternate financing mechanisms, the more trepidation I have. It's frightening enough when you look at individual parks, especially waterfront parks. I think we're seeing right now a really interesting case study with Hudson River Park. Hudson River Park was one of the early parks to follow this self-sustaining model for maintenance. But what we found now, after a number of years into it, is that there is an incredible amount of deferred capital maintenance that wasn't really accounted for when thinking about this self-sustaining maintenance model. That really only covered day-to-day operations, not these tremendous costs that will continue to come up because especially on waterfront. I mean, that's the case in any park, but especially on waterfront when you're talking about pilings and piers and bulkheads and all of the costs associated with just maintaining the basic infrastructure of the park. But even when you step back and then you look at all of the waterfront parks that are coming online now, and so you're expediting that, and then you step back further as a group like New Yorkers for Parks does and look at the 2,100 parks in the system altogether, not just the waterfront. And I think it raises some very serious concerns. The number one recommendation in the RPA report that Rob referred to is that we need more money for the Parks Department. Well, that's true, but I don't think that's going to happen anytime soon. And when you dig into the budget a little further, you realize that in some ways we're creating, I think, a public complacency about the funding situation. Because the capital budget is very different than the expense budget. And this is sort of the fundamental issue with how the city's budget works. It is much easier to come by capital dollars. You can bond for them, and as long as the city's credit is good, you can get capital dollars. So literally hundreds of millions of dollars are going into building these new parks, and that's capital money, and that's great. But I think it's sort of setting the scene in the public at large that parks are in okay shape. We're doing okay. I mean, we couldn't be building the High Line and Governor's Island and Brooklyn Bridge Park if we didn't have a lot of money for parks. Well, that money is one pot, but it is completely separate from the expense budget, which is where the maintenance money comes from. And you can't mix the two, because you can't bond and you can't use the city's credit for expense money, for personnel, and for all of the other things that go into maintenance. There's very specific rules about when you can use capital money, and those are large capital projects. Even repairs are generally not capitally eligible. So this is a significant issue, that, and I think that not only is the issue there, since 2008, the parks maintenance and operations budget has been cut by 23%. That's just in 5 years. They're cutting, right now, the budget that's being negotiated is looking at cutting almost 800 job training participant jobs. Already, our maintenance crew in parks is made up of temporary workers that cycle out within 6 months. And this is the kind of situation that we're talking about, a very bare-bones situation. So as we're bringing all this new parkland, particularly this particularly expensive parkland that is sort of world-class parks and beautiful, we are exacerbating a situation that is very significant. The other issue that I'm very concerned about is, are we creating a system that is going to end up with an inherently inequitable park system? All of these processes and alternate financing mechanisms that have been talked about are fairly dependent on a high-value market. Concessions, if you look at park improvement districts that take assessments from the land around it, bids, which are similar to bids, TIF piloting, private developers using some of the money from the project to go into it, those are all reliant on market value. And so when you look at the most of the parks that we're creating now, most of them are created in high-value districts. And what does that mean for the parts of the city that cannot support these alternate financing mechanisms? Are they out of luck? And I think a good example is if you look at what's going on with the Bronx River, tremendous amount of work coming, bringing back a waterfront parks on the Bronx River, but the money is not there at the level that it is at these other places that can just raise money. And in fact, there was an effort to hook up a development that's happening in the Bronx at West Farms to try to get some money from that to help pay for that. Well, wearing my affordable housing hat from my past life, there's just not the money there. You cannot knock those dollars off of those kinds of projects the way you can at Brooklyn Bridge Park. And so I fear that if this system, if we sort of get comfortable about a system that relies on private money to sustain parks, we are going to see an increasingly inequitable park system.
Thank you very much. And I get to go last and don't have a PowerPoint. So it's good. You've heard everything that you need to hear at this point. So now the politician will weigh in. I think that a number of the different points raised are significant ones, and I actually think that sort of the one that hangs out there that should hang over all of us is the final of Holly's point, which is, as we talk about what we're doing on the waterfront today, what the current vision is, I think there's a lot here, and frankly a lot that we could be doing that we have not yet done in this city. When we talk about the broader question, you know, in some ways the most telling slide of the entire, of all the presentations was the one that showed just what a small percentage of the Prospect Park maintenance and operations actually comes from tax levy, and the extent to which the entire dependence on conservancies that we've seen that has remade Prospect Park in Brooklyn, where I live, remade Central Park, is the first generation of the problem that Holly, I think, took us to the conclusion of. And so, sort of granted that issue hangs over all of us and that there need to be solutions to that, that is not so much to me a waterfront park issue as a parks and open space issue and a fundamental policy issue for the city moving forward. The waterfront issue is also a critical one for the city and really on the upside. There's enormous potential to build 21st century public works, which no longer seem possible in this city at this moment through what's happening really in the harbor and what is really a linked, in my view, a harbor park, which is a central park in a different part of the city and is every bit as important a public work as Central Park and Prospect Park were in the 19th century. We're doing it differently, though, for a couple of the reasons people have talked about. I think one important one to point out is the alphabet soup that you have touching the harbor today. Brooklyn Bridge Park is under the aegis of the city, but is run as an independent authority. Governor's Island as well. Hudson River Park is a state city entity run independently. The East River Waterfront, where we're seeing enormous development and investment, is run by the City Economic Development Corporation. Battery Park is heavily run and influenced by an extraordinarily strong and well-funded conservancy. And along some of the northern parts of the East River, you have state parks still controlling East River State Park and others. So you have a real atomization at the same time that you have the enormous needs, maintenance and operations, also the capital maintenance needs, in each of these. And of course, Battery Park City, by the way, is run as an independent entity for that waterfront open space. And I think in some ways what we've done in New York is we have begun the investment, but we've really done it in sort of the 1.0 version. So I represent Brooklyn Bridge Park, where there was the concept that it had to be self-sustaining. And sort of the baseline solution was to literally build specific towers within sort of the broader footprint of what had initially been conceived of as the park, in addition to concessions and to some of the other things that we talked about. Hudson River Park, which I also represent, you have sort of an act that was passed that did get the park done and moving forward, which is an enormous accomplishment, but also it sort of is silent as to some of the options that we've heard discussed today. And so I do think that 10 years ago, 15 years ago, there was a view that there were only a couple of ways to do this. Are you going to build housing? Are you going to get sufficient commercial or concessions? Are you going to have sufficient parking? And that's the way we're going to do the park. I think that what's happened over the last decade is that we've seen that it's not a binary, it's not that simple a question. Each one of those questions isn't binary, right? Certainly in New York, as you build and develop parks, you want to have some of the value of real estate. Nothing happens in New York without capturing some of the value of real estate. The question is, what does that look like? Can you transfer development rights to a space sort of within the region that can use it and actually keep development out of the park or farther away from the park? Can you use a TIF or not even a TIF? Can you use the understanding that we now have that these parks are creating broad value in addition to the specific value that you would capture in a TIF in the areas around them, right? I guess it was RPA a couple of years ago that found the enormous property tax value increases in the block immediately surrounding Hudson River Park. And is it possible to think a little bit more broadly about what value we're getting out of these parks in order to fund them? So there's sort of two questions, right? Public funding can come in two ways. It can come sort of by saying the current general fund, the current tax levy is going to immediately have a new operational obligation it hasn't had in the past. That's the sort of the traditional mechanism. Or you can say, look, we're building a public amenity and a public good that's going to create value over time. The city or the general fund is going to get less of that value than they otherwise would, but they're still going to overall be ahead of where they are today. And they're not going to have a liability beyond what they have today. I think in a lot of ways, as this park financing schemes for Brooklyn Bridge Park, for Governor's Island, for Hudson River Park, were moving forward, only that first question was asked. And I think we're now getting to a point where we're focusing on that second question. I think the High Line, which is not a waterfront park, but it has, I think, many of the same features in terms of additional capital maintenance needs, in terms of an expansion that would only happen in a self-financing way, has changed that conversation. At Brooklyn Bridge Park, we tried to change that conversation by creating an agreement that frankly may or may not consummate, but as an idea is actually now something we've done in New York City because it exists as an agreement, which is to say, if you can get new properties on the tax rolls quickly and at a higher value than you otherwise would, partially because that's what's happening, partially because, frankly, you need to finance a park, and that's a way, as I said, to find public financing without creating a negative obligation, a negative sum as compared to today. And because we know from the Hudson River Park study and others that we are getting broader increased value by building these amenities in open space. Can you use new properties on the tax rolls that have additional tax value because of rezonings? And can you direct some of those towards the park? This is a model that we've used with the Jehovah's Witnesses buildings, which are 3 million square feet that are off the tax rolls in Brooklyn Bridge Park right now, and zoned manufacturing. If they are sold onto the tax rolls and zoned residential, increasing their revenue within a time frame, then you're not going to have development within Brooklyn Bridge Park or at the edge of Brooklyn Bridge Park, depending on how you define it. Instead, what you're going to do is you're actually going to be financing from a broader array of properties based on a new income stream. Similarly, when you look at Hudson River Park, what's going to happen with the Javits expansion site? What's going to happen with Javits over time? Are there areas, not just within one block, but within a quarter mile or a half mile, where we know that we are going to want upzonings, we know we're going to want changes of use over time? We know that's going to be a more successful conclusion because of Hudson River Park, because we have a better city with an extraordinary waterfront open space. And does it make sense to change our expectations for how much of that revenue is going to go into the general fund? Again, with always the baseline being that we can't shrink the general fund or increase the general fund obligations from today. But are there opportunities to fund these parks with the rising tide? And it's sort of a softer version of a TIF in some ways. It doesn't necessarily have the features of a PID. And one advantage of it is I'm not sure that it could be used across the entire Bronx River, frankly, because there may not be enough value even in sort of the broader areas of the West Bronx. But certainly it's going to be more applicable in more places. It's not just Lower Manhattan and the area around Brooklyn Heights, right? As you talked about North Brooklyn and Long Island City, those are areas where the specific development at some point you may not be able to do, but you can do this. You're going to be able to do it along the west side, all the way uptown. And so it's another way of thinking about these. And I think that the five funding mechanisms that we heard about previously, the interesting thing is three of those five, I don't believe were on the table when we first started talking about Hudson River Park and Brooklyn Bridge Park and Governor's Island. And so what are the 21st century funding mechanisms? Maybe a little bit more complex, maybe a little bit more of a complicated relationship with the public dollars that can allow these things to become a reality. And you know, the one last point I would make is, if we can't figure it out for Governor's Island, which is in some ways the most challenging of these, right? It's out in the middle of the harbor. Then we probably aren't going to reach the goal that we have around our waterfront. If we can figure it out for Governor's Island, the rest of it is going to get solved completely. It's not clear entirely how the different ideas I talked about relate to the Governor's Island question, but in some ways the great news about Governor's Island is we have a test case that's extraordinarily important for those of us who care about the waterfront that is on the margins in terms of how extraordinarily difficult it'll be to find $20 million a year. And so that should always be our test filter as we think about the long-term sustainability of these parks. And just to circle back finally, we do have a larger issue, and I look forward to seeing all of you at a broader parks conference talking about how we're going to fund parks and communities that need them so desperately and don't have conservancies or any of these other options available to them. Thank you.
Well, great job in sort of laying out these challenges and maybe, you know, some solutions with the Senator's remarks. Let me turn that back to Chris and Jamie a little bit in terms of some of the kind of version 2.0 ideas that Senator Squadron laid out, thinking about kind of a soft version of TIFs, thinking about incorporating maybe on a district-wide level some of the expected increases. Is that something that's possible, doable?
I'm
sorry. The idea of sort of taking the 2.0 idea of a soft TIFs district and using that revenue, that rising tide that we know that parks create to help finance operations and maintenance.
I I agree. There's a lot of potential for that. And as Senator Squadron said, in fact, although again it's not a waterfront park, the High Line is always the best example of some of these leading edge efforts where, I think the sort of as the economic development consultant in the room, the analytical task that supports this sort of synthetic or soft TIF, this means of financing new open space on waterfronts where it's very expensive because of the incremental value that's created, that's effectively the story of the High Line, where the city was unwilling to commit to keeping the rail line and turning it into a park until a series of things happened, but one of them included making a set of projections that showed that the inclusion of a park in the West Chelsea district in the midst of all the other things that were going on could reasonably be expected to have what was then projected as being a $250 million incremental tax value to the city over 20 years. And I think that was the public policy rationale for making the capital expenditure in that park. So it's as an analytic tool and approach, it's a very effective thing to do. And in fact, we went back recently and looked at what the results have been just in the 3 years since the High Line was built. And obviously, we all know that it's generated a ton of economic activity. The projection that we made now, based on 3 years of activity, is that the city will have more than $1 billion in net present value tax return over 20 years. So it's an investment that's very much paid off.
I think Governor's Island is a good example or good model for thinking about what alternative financing strategies might work. Commercial uses, if we just run through the possibilities, commercial uses probably won't do it if you're talking about $20 million. Brooklyn Bridge Park Corporation did a study recently about how they might finance their $16 million a year operating budget if there was no residential development within the park. And what they found essentially is that they could not do it. That concessions in parks and commercial uses in parks, restaurants, et cetera, won't raise enough money. And I don't think they would on Governor's Island either. Private management, let's put that one aside for now. Tax increment financing, I don't think that would work either on Governor's Island because the development options on Governor's Island are too restricted by the federal law that deeded it to the city of New York. There isn't enough private development that's going to happen there to pay back the bonds that you need to do what you need to do on Governor's Island. I don't think. Transfer of development rights might work. There's a lot of open space on Governor's Island. Perhaps we could create a zoning scheme where those development rights could be sold to neighboring parts of Brooklyn or Manhattan and thereby preserve and fund the maintenance of open space on Governor's Island. So I think there are some interesting things to be played with on Governor's Island.
I just want to say one thing about the High Line that I think is an interesting thing to think about, and in the model of the Park Improvement District, which there isn't one yet in New York, the bids are the closest thing, but I think there really is not a maintenance plan yet for the High Line other than that it attracts a ton of private donations and private money. All concessions, once they start doing more concessions, all that money will stay within it, but concessions only go so far, especially for such an expensive park to maintain. I think one of the lessons that's important about the High Line is the importance of thinking about the maintenance on before day one. When they tried to go back to the neighborhood that has created that for which they have created so much obvious value and created a park improvement district that would take an assessment on the surrounding neighborhood, the neighbors wouldn't do it. And I think that it's much harder to get neighbors interested in helping to pay for the maintenance if they already have the beautiful park and it's there. Why should I do that now? So I really think it's key that these things get thought of up front. The way that the bids happened at Bryant Park and Madison Park and others is because those parks were in terrible condition and were literally affecting the businesses around them. That was the inspiration where people, the businesses, would put money into those parks. If we have the beautiful park and it's done, and then we say to neighbors, now we want you to help pay for it, I think that is a very, very hard sell, and we're seeing that. I hope it works. I think Hudson River Park may be one where we try to bring that model because the financial situation of that is very great, and I think the trust is doing a good job of getting that message out. But I think this is a real question of making sure we're thinking about that up front.
I think one of the questions, we got some great questions from the audience. You know, I think one of the issues you raised, Senator, was the fact that there are a number of different authorities operating on the waterfront. You know, there's a great benefit to that in that they're very focused on their particular part of the waterfront and you know, can respond quickly in some ways to community concerns. Obviously, there's it does lend itself to the two-tiered system. Are there ways at a state level to help bridge those divides? And in particular, one question from the audience is both the Environmental Protection Fund and specifically the which relies on real estate transfer tax revenues to help finance capital improvements in parks. Is there something that could be replicated, either increased on the state side or replicated along a district, let's say, that encompassed numerous parks?
Just to start with the baseline, and I'll get to the question. I think another problem or another concern when you have great deal of multiple entities is each one of these has a fairly significant operations obligation moving forward. Presumably, some of them are going to figure it out and some of them aren't, and to the extent you get a bonanza in one place, you'd like to use it somewhere else. The other is Governor's Island is the most challenging, as was laid out, and in sort of a way that's fairly incontrovertible, but the question is there value for the other spaces in Governor's Island success or not? And so, you know, it could be that part of the path there is actually to think about linkages with some of the other places where there are some options on the table. I think that the 1.0 options will never get us there, but the 2.0 might, and it can that be one of the paths for Governor's Island? In terms of specifically, like I would love to see more money out of the Environmental Protection Fund in general, in the state, and certainly in the five boroughs. Of course, the state has been going the other direction. We were able to hold off or not even have proposed cuts to the EPF this year, but that's the first year, I think, since I've been in office that we haven't had to fight back cuts to the EPF. So in the same way that the city is not increasing their operations investment in parks over time, I think that's true of the state as well. And I actually think that certainly for this room and as a thought exercise, look, if the city decides to have a different tax structure and to have a different parks budget, if you know the 1% movement for parks and culture is successful and it's a movement I support, then we're in great shape. I think that the reason we're all here and the reason this is a challenge is we need to assume those two things aren't going to happen. We should fight for them every year as a budget. We should probably fight for them broadly, but is there a solution outside of those? If there's not, then we'll just be left on the picket line together fighting for the funding. If there is, God knows we want it because it's a lot more likely to come true than either state or city funding at a sufficient level.
I just want to follow up on the Environmental Protection Fund, which I think is a cautionary tale for us today. The Environmental Protection Fund was created 2 decades ago to be a dedicated source of funding for parks in New York State. New York State created a real estate transfer tax, which generated hundreds of millions of dollars in revenues, which was supposed to go into the Environmental Protection Fund to be allocated for park purposes. And what the legislature has done over the past 2 decades is to sweep 30 or 40% or more of that revenue into the general operating budget to cover shortfalls, which has dramatically reduced the amount of money that's available for park purposes. Thanks to the legislature, we've managed to keep it alive each year for the past few years, but it's a fraction of the real estate transfer tax revenues. So when we think about alternative financing strategies for parks in New York City, we should make sure that they cannot be converted to other purposes. One of the nice things about tax increment finance is that if New York City issues bonds to pay for park improvements, it has to use the revenues, the tax revenues from that project to pay back the bondholders. It cannot use those funds for other purposes. So I think EPF is really a cautionary tale for us.
And just related to that, not to go on too long about a funding stream that I don't think is going to be successful, but it's actually also an important argument or case for having a plan and a strategy for where operations funding is going to come from, but not pretending too greatly that it's an absolutely independent entity or independent system, right? When you get a financing system that has anything left over, the truth is the city or the state or the level of government is going to take it for themselves, and once they have, they'll take it forever. See it with EPF, you see it with lottery in terms of education, you see it again and again. And as an alternative, if a park starts to completely fall apart, as we're seeing with Hudson River, not fall apart, but have the potential of falling apart, you're gonna find solutions either through changing the rules or getting a greater deal of investment. So the real question is, how can we responsibly build these things in a way that policymakers are comfortable with, in a way that sort of takes the broader goals into mind? The extent to which, and I've had this argument many times on Brooklyn Bridge Park, including with some of the people sitting here today, look, it's self-financing, we need to be responsible about that, it needs to be financed, but the illusion that it exists on a separate budget the way, you know, Dwayne Reed does is simply not the case, and we need to be cognizant of that as we talk about the solutions. I also need to apologize, I need to leave a little early because another waterfront use we have is the Navy Yard with jobs, and there's a major announcement about new jobs at the Navy Yard, which is actually potentially could be a Governor's Island path as well, so forgive me for leaving early, and thank you very, very much.
Well, let's talk a little bit about some of the other issues that the senator's bringing up. How do we balance this? And Holly mentioned the idea of affordable housing, paying for parks, doesn't really work so good. How do we do systems like that, like this that we're talking about? Capturing value from real estate in places where there's industrial uses along the waterfront, or in places where perhaps there are other public goods being generated. Are there some good models from elsewhere? Now you have to tell us. I think that's the.
It's a tough question. Chris's model of tax increment financing. There's a lot of reasons why it hasn't been as successfully used in New York as in other places. In terms of tying commercial development to tax increment financing, we have, unfortunately, something of a cautionary tale in Hudson Yards, which is effectively a synthetic tax increment financing tool where the city backstopped the bonds and the development hasn't materialized. Commercial development is, in our city, in many ways, much more subject to broader cycles, there's a lot more risk in many cases in tying revenue-based financing mechanisms to commercial activity. But having said that, we've got a working waterfront really all around the city. So many miles of linear waterfront, and a working waterfront in places like Sunset Park that does yield very significant commercial development opportunities. And I think the city has been very effective in making sure that we tie that commercial development to the creation of open space as well. Sunset Park is going to have a great set of open spaces on the waterfront, but at the same time, a revitalized industrial district. And that's an example of where doing something as transformative as that, in the absence of a lot of incremental value that you can capture, the cities just have to step in and finance it to an extent that they probably didn't want to.
But I just, in terms of the balance, I think there are real policy questions. In New York City, we have dedicated now, in the past decade, the majority of Manhattan's coastline to waterfront parks, some of which are really beautiful. But then we have the trouble of siting sanitation piers and other quasi-industrial uses in New York City. And I'm not sure that we've balanced things correctly in Manhattan, and we ought to think about that in the outer boroughs as we go forward with Newtown Creek, with the Brooklyn waterfront, with the Queens waterfront. There need to be places for industrial development. Otherwise, you'll be keeping the industrial uses out of the parks and putting them into residential neighborhoods or into other parks.
I think New York is evolving a little late on the kind of mixed uses on the waterfront. If you go to a lot of European cities, I think of Lisbon as a great example of a place that has a very active working waterfront, but also a very publicly accessible waterfront. I think it's an interesting moment in time in New York because there has been kind of historically a very pristine view of parks. And I think the economic reality is forcing people to kind of rethink that a little bit. But I think that as long as decisions are guided by public accessibility to make sure that things aren't, that these spaces aren't privatized in a way that the public feels excluded from them, if that guides our decision making, I think that the mix of uses is a healthy one.
And what about the balance between sort of public parks, this idea of public parks generating higher real estate values, and the desire to keep sort of mixed income neighborhoods on the waterfront, you know, available to a range of New Yorkers? Is there a...
I think it's really hard. The only... It's out there as a model at on the Greenpoint Williamsburg waterfront. I think we're still waiting to see if that works or not. But you know, the affordability there is only 20%. We're not talking about a significant amount of affordable housing there. Hunters Point South on the Long Island City waterfront is one, and I think this one will actually work, but it will be interesting to see, where as part of the RFP, it was required, the city, EDC, is building the waterfront park, but it is required that the developer, which is a team of Related and Phipps Houses, has to pay for the ongoing maintenance. And that was put in the RFP and was a requirement, and that is worked into the budget that they created when they won the RFP. So, you know, in that case, that's a mixed income model, but it's 100%, it's supposed to be 100% affordable. I think it will be interesting to see if that works over time. A lot of these things are just so early in the process that we really don't know yet what is going to work and what isn't. But again, I think even Long Island City, there's enough value there in that project, but a lot of other projects aren't going to have enough value to have 100% affordable housing kicking off money for a park.
I think this raises the question of how we bring some of this alternative financing to neighborhoods in the outer boroughs that are inherently affordable and will never become like Tribeca or Greenwich Village next to Hudson River Park. How do we make some of these models work along the Bronx River or next to Van Cortlandt Park or on the North Shore of Staten Island, where there's a tremendous potential for a boom in middle class housing development, I think, if we build the sort of parks and other infrastructure to promote it and to go along with it. And that's how we have to think about how we make this happen. What happened at Hudson River Park happened on the North Shore of Staten Island or along the Bronx River. Holly, maybe it's not possible, but I hope it is.
Can sort of green jobs be kind of part of that equation for lower income neighborhoods? The idea that parks, you know, both create direct, you know, sort of indirect value, but also are a source of employment and economic opportunity for neighborhood residents. Can that be part of the picture?
I think all of these things can be part of the picture, but I think you're talking about a fairly significant policy change in how you look at the relationship among different sources of financing and different elements of the economy. It's very difficult to get agencies, much less OMB, to think about the value one agency is creating to offset the other, because everybody's in there in their little narrow tunnel, and they have their budgets, and that's what they're working from. I mean, when I was at HPD, we would have arguments with the other agencies all the time, because if parks wanted a park, then our HPD subsidy was going to help pay for that park if we were doing affordable housing. If EDC wanted a purchase price for a piece of land that affordable housing was on, our money was going to that. And I think this requires very high level leadership at the mayoral and deputy mayor level to have a major policy shift that says if we're creating green jobs, those 300 jobs that are being created at the Navy Yard, that is this level of value, and therefore that can help pay for a park. That simply, as I think the Bloomberg administration has been pretty good at integrating agencies, but it is still a far cry from getting to that place where you have that kind of cross-agency policy thinking.
On the substance of the question around mixing uses, you know, there's a set of really interesting planning issues that are raised by the last two questions, because one is about creating mixed income and affordable housing on the waterfront, which in our city and most cities is largely isolated from public transit. And so, you know, one of the issues with the projects where we're putting in mixed income is that we're not providing transit accessibility to jobs where folks are much more dependent on them if they're living in affordable housing. So the sort of planning initiatives that we see in places like the Home Port, where it will hopefully, once the phases get done, see a mix of uses and employment that is within walking distance of housing, is something else that's got to get integrated into this mix of thinking strategically about waterfront and economic development.
I think one thing that we all would agree in trying to find this balance is that the bulk of the capital money to build these parks in the first place is going to have to come from the public sector. I mean, you might be able to supplement that through a TIF district, but for the kind of infrastructure, are there opportunities to tap into to kind of use, I think Madeline raised earlier today, the idea of the waterfront being sort of part of an integrated property protection infrastructure, part of the, obviously the highway, Route 9A is part of the park here. Are there opportunities to use other pools of capital to help finance the park, including maybe in creating sort of an endowment of some sort to help ongoing maintenance of those facilities?
Yeah, I mean, unfortunately, in terms of capital, fewer and fewer opportunities.
Yeah, granted.
And I think, people who are trying to string together public financing for waterfront open space 10 or 15 years ago had so much more access to federal and state sources than they do today. I mean, back to this discussion we had about state sources, but the feds are in the same position where there's been, there's a lot of different sources to tap into, but, just even working now versus 5 years ago on trying to string together a capital budget that gets sourced partly from federal funds is so much more difficult because of all the things that we know about in Washington. So that's a real challenge. I do think that the use of endowments for O&M increasingly is worth looking at and thinking about. It doesn't help on the capital side, but there are instances, for example, we were talking about the Toronto waterfront development, and in that case, a decision was made to reduce the capital budget of the open space that would be built by 10% and put that 10% left over into a fund that would, in sort of a sneaky way, fund capital maintenance for the first 3 or 4 years, which really just means maintenance. If there's enough capital available, shifting it to O&M is extremely complicated under our statutory constraints, but also possible and has a lot of potential.
I think it's a good model. When I've been asked by foundations and private givers, where is the money most needed in the park system, I think an endowment for maintenance is exactly where some of those private dollars should go, because it is easier to come up with the money to build out, and we don't have endless sources. And so I think that is a good place. And I guess the last big Highline gift, the $20 million, was for a maintenance endowment. I think that model for private giving is an important one to think about.
The only park that I'm aware of that has raised real maintenance dollars from private donations is Central Park, which has been fabulously successful in creating an endowment and raising money each year. I don't think that will work in outside of Central Park. It's certainly not going to work in the outer borough neighborhoods that keep me up at night. And there we need to think about getting private development dollars to create endowments, using a transfer of development rights scheme to sell development rights from open space and take that money and make sure it goes into a permanent, untouchable endowment.
But yeah, just to jump back in, on the private contribution side, there's always the potential in the fact that it's all just money, and so there's you're much less constrained on collecting private dollars. I'm sort of familiar with some innovations underway right now where people are just selling naming rights and corporate sponsorship opportunities for major capital investments within either existing or new parks, but just putting the money in an endowment. And most donors, if you really explain to them what this real inequity is between capital and operating funding, are willing to put up with something like that.
What about other, going back to the shared infrastructure and integrated infrastructure idea, is there an opportunity to use, the growing need for thinking about shoreline protection and climate adaptation, and the fact that so many private property owners pay, and the city is sort of self-financed for insurance purposes, use that sort of risk and the need to create insurance as a means of making improvements to waterfront parks? I don't know if I articulated that correctly, but I think you guys got the idea.
Well, you made
the point. I'm sorry. So I think the idea, you know, obviously waterfront property protects the rest of the city and the rest of property owners against flooding, sea level rise, and something that's going to be increasingly important in the future. Is there a way to tap that pool of insurance premiums, if you will, in kind of a simple way of thinking about it, and risk as a means of financing improvements and maintenance along the waterfront?
I don't know if I can answer that question, but something related to it comes from Governor Cuomo's 2010 election document, his manifesto, if you will, which put a dollar amount on what he called ecosystem services provided by parks and open space. In other words, what parks do beyond just providing recreation is protect our coastlines from flooding, clean the air, and provide a number of other benefits. So I think that we need to sell that story and develop that story a little bit more about how open space and parks have other benefits in protecting shoreline from erosion and other things like that. It's probably in the range of trillions of dollars per year in services. If we can get that story out there, then we can tap into some other sources of funding for open space and park maintenance.
So let me, we have a few minutes left, let me kind of close and challenge our panel here a little bit. You know, it's clear there's no kind of, you know, magic bullet out there. It'd be nice if there was one. Could each of you kind of describe sort of what you would view as being, and I was struck by the image you showed, Jamie, that showed that only 68% of the urban parks nationally relied on general public funds for part of their maintenance budget. But could you describe sort of the ideal budget scenario for a waterfront park, you know, public versus private, and what sources of private, to kind of get that right balance between sort of affordability and protecting the public interest?
It's interesting. Yeah. Let's go for specific numbers.
Yeah, I'm not sure about the dollar amounts, but
we'd all like to be at 100% public and then go from there.
Look, I think realistically, none of these alternate financing mechanisms should be off the table, and I think it's probably going to be a patchwork quilt of looking at a bunch of different ones. And I think the key is, to the degree that new parks come online, this is all thought about before they come online so we don't run into the situations later. But I think one of the important things that needs to get done as the parks that can generate these various private dollars is there needs to be a baseline, and there needs to be a policy decision by the city that these private dollars that come in are augmenting the public budget, not displacing it. And that's the only way you're going to prevent the inequity in the park system. So that if we all agree that having conservancies and raising private money is a good thing, which I think it is, if that isn't suddenly just depleting the money that parks gets for other parks that can't afford those kinds of systems. And so I think the key is to have the actual dollar amounts of how much a baseline budget for parks, and then having all these private dollars very carefully calculated so we know how much private money is coming in and where it's coming in, and that becomes money so that the public money can get offset for the parks that can't afford these various systems.
I think the breakdown is different for each park. When you think about Hudson River Park and Brooklyn Bridge Park, they were created, one through a statute and one through a memorandum of understanding, where it was explicit that those parks would be self-sustaining. And so there, frankly, I think that the funds need to come almost exclusively from the private sector, at least for maintenance after the parks are built out. For other waterfront parks, existing parks, Jamaica Bay, Great Kills, other beautiful parks that I think get forgotten about in these waterfront conferences, The public dollars should be a much bigger share of maintenance. They should be. And we owe it to those communities to make sure they are.
And I think I just have to agree with all of that. I mean, there are, I'd come back to what I was saying before, which is that there's this deep connection between leveraging different sources of financing and actually creating value in a park. And there are a number of successful models across the country now where, you know, they sort of achieve a third kind of distribution with a third public funding, which includes these tax increments and proceeds from real estate development on publicly owned land, a third from earned income that occurs within the park, and a third from private and philanthropic support. But the most important thing about that, coming back to Holly's very important point about sort of this you know, always this divide between growth and equity, is that we have to be able to demonstrate that bringing in those private sources and requiring that stable base of public funding adds some increment in economic value to our city. And in some ways, you know, I think we'd all say that the waterfront parks and the other parks in the prosperous parts of Manhattan that we've created over the last 10 or 15 years, they're almost something completely different from neighborhood parks. I mean, they have neighborhood park characteristics, but they bring in people who don't otherwise come and visit the city. I mean, not to go back to the High Line, I just have all the numbers in my head. The High Line, 40% of visitors to the High Line come from outside the five boroughs, and many of them would not otherwise come and visit the city. So we have to be able to, I think the sort of threshold question in putting public funds in an expensive waterfront park is we have to be able to establish that it's adding new value, which in turn can be turned back and directed into our park system through some of the mechanisms that we're talking about.
Well, listen, I think it's time for lunch. I'm getting a nod in agreement with everybody. Thank you so much to our panelists and to all of you for a series of great questions.